to Collider Nightmares. I'm so happy to be back. Yay, Collider Nightmares. My name is my name is Clarke Wolfe. It's so nice to see you after being away at Fantastic Fest in Austin, Texas. I'm so happy to be back with my Nightmares family. So let's introduce them. To my left is Miss Perri Nemiroff.
I am so happy you're back. I'm so insanely jealous.
Well,
meat and booze and movies. I'm pretty sure you had the best week ever.
That is the tagline for Fantastic Fest. And I think I have turned into a piece of bacon at this point. So mission accomplished. Yes, I've seen a lot of really cool things. I know you guys talked about Autopsy of Jane Doe last week on the show. It was a great show, by the way. Great job, Perri and team.
Thank you.
Autopsy of Jane Doe was, I think, my number three favorite movie I saw at Fantastic Fest.
Nice.
And it's coming out in December, so keep watching. And to her left, we have a very special guest today, the one and only Mr. Cody Hall.
Yay! I'm not John Schnepp. How's it going, guys?
You
happy to be here.
You are not John Schnepp, but we are so happy that you are here.
I'm happy to be here. Thank you.
How someone could confuse the two, though.
Yeah, we're very similar in height.
And to my right is my Wolves of Steel partner in crime, Mr. Mark Reilly.
Death has come to your town, Sheriff. And what I mean by that, Halloween is almost upon us. Yes, that was a quote from Halloween. So excited, guys. Collider Nightmares and Team's Wolves of Steel happening here today.
Today, so, our first battle.
Word, by the time you see this, the episode will be up, so... Yeah.
Check it out, y'all. It is Halloween month, by the way. It's October, you guys.
Had to mention.
It's about time.
This is the most wonderful time of the year. We're going to be doing something kind of special towards the end of the show. We'll be doing it every week in October. So be sure to stay tuned for that. Before we get into our fresh meat, some really exciting news and interesting news kind of broke today. Chloe Grace Moretz is joining the Suspiria remake. There she is, looking all pretty and spooky. She's joining the already cast Tilda Swinton and Dakota Johnson. Now, David Gordon Green will be producing. He was trying to get this remake off the ground for a really long time as a longtime fan of Suspiria. But he has sort of passed the reins on to a bigger splash director, Luca Guadagnino.
I don't know if that's
sure,
right.
Sure, we're going to go with that.
I
apologize. Luca, I look forward to seeing your film. I'm sorry I am so white and can't pronounce anything. But with that being said, this is really interesting news because, as I said, look, Suspiria, they've been trying to remake Suspiria for years. And I feel like there have been various incarnations of this story, but now it really looks like it's going. And Chloe Grace Moretz, by the way, I forget who pointed it out on Twitter, but she's kind of like the unofficial remake Scream Queen, isn't
right?
she?
Yeah.
Let Me In, Carrie, something called The Eye, I think, which I don't know. But anyway, Chloe's all over it. So guys, I put it to you. You know, do we have any big Suspiria fans on the panel? Because I will be the first to reveal that I don't love Suspiria. I love the idea of Suspiria. I love the visuals, and I think Goblin's score is great. But I do think that it's a movie that could really be ripe for a remake.
Yeah, I think I'm with you on that. I don't not like it, but it's definitely not a movie that I go back and watch ever, really. So I think it's probably prime for a remake right now. With Chloe Moretz, I don't know. I'm not the biggest Chloe Moretz fan.
Okay.
I also find it really weird that she drops out of The Little Mermaid and then picks up Suspiria. That's one heck of a shift. But
yeah.
I love her in movies like Kick-Ass. I think she is great in Let Me In. But for the most part, I like her as an actress when she's playing big, bold, crazy characters. Or like in Clouds of Sils Maria when she's playing like an obnoxious starlet. But for the most part... I'm just never really feeling her. What's that one YA movie she made? Oh, If I Stay.
I did not have a pleasure. I'm gonna get killed now for that.
Yeah.
Well, so gentlemen, I put it to you, even if you haven't seen the film, if you're not a big fan of the film, the rest of the cast, Tilda Swinton, joining on board, and Dakota Johnson, who has worked with this director before. Actually, both of them worked together on a bigger splash. So he basically took these two leading ladies and is bringing them over into the horror genre. What are you guys thinking about this?
Yeah, I haven't seen the original, obviously, because I'm 8 years old. But
yeah.
I'm a huge fan of Chloe Moretz. I thought she dropped out of like Hollywood like a couple weeks ago or something like that. Now she's doing this. But I love her in Let Me In, and then What was the other one we're talking about?
Kick-Ass.
Kick-Ass, of course, is obviously awesome. So I'm down for this. And it's about witches and stuff. And if that's done right, it could be super duper creepy.
Absolutely. Riley?
Well, I'm also 8 years old, so I haven't. I take it back. So I was in USC Film School, and we did study Suspiria, but I don't remember seeing it, which is weird. I'm very familiar with the tone, the style, all of that, the name itself. So I'm interested in the cast. I'm not a crazy huge Chloe Moretz fan either. I thought she was okay in Carrie. I just, for me, that was the remake was a little off for me personally. So I'm really mixed on this.
Yeah.
It's on one hand, you got Tilda Swinton that I will get behind in anything she does. But on the other hand, this is a remake, and it's such a, even if you haven't seen the movie, you've heard of Suspiria. So it's one of those things where I go, okay. Another remake, but I know there's some passion behind the project. I know that the director and Dave Gordon Green, it's something they've been wanting to do for a very long time. So if you have that passion, great. Maybe it's going to turn out a great movie. So I'm kind of mixed. I could go either way with it. Let's see the first trailer, then I'll decide.
It's interesting that Amazon is the one that acquired worldwide distribution rights and is financing the production too. So I'm curious to see just like what path it takes.
You know, it's interesting because I believe wasn't Amazon the one that distributed Neon Demon as well? I'm 99% sure Amazon Studios distributed Neon Demon. And, you know, it is absolutely not the same thing, but to me, they kind of live in the same neighborhood. This idea of like, you know, really dangerous women and beautiful women and what beauty means and what the horrors are attached to it. It's just, I don't know, there's something about this that I'm just like, what kind of direction is Amazon Studios going if they're acquiring these types of projects?
You are right. They did distribute Neon Demon.
Well,
there it is.
You're welcome. Okay, guys, you tell us, you know, are you a big Dario Argento fan? Are Dario Argento's films untouchable? Is Suspiria untouchable? I look forward to hearing your comments and reading your comments. And with that, let's get into our fresh meat.
Fresh
squish.
Come on, Cody, join
me. Yeah.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Come on.
That's
how you
play
the trial by fire. I apologize.
Right. There you go.
All right, so by now, you probably know that Universal Pictures is planning reboots of all of their classic monsters, including Tom Cruise leading the mummy, Russell Crowe as Dr. Henry Jekyll, Javier Bardem as Frankenstein's monster, and Johnny Depp as the Invisible Man. But what we have all heard little to nothing about is if Luke Evans would be reprising his role as Vlad the Impaler, who later becomes Dracula. Now, while not successful here in the States, Dracula Untold was a huge hit internationally and ended in present day, which would allow some to assume that Evans Dracula could join the rest of the rebooted team. This week, while promoting his latest film, The Girl on the Train, Evan was asked about his future role in the Universal Monsters franchise and told LRM.com this: "There have been talks and conversations. I think the bigger picture is exciting for all of the monsters that they own. There is talk about it. I just don't know how it will all manifest itself. I think it will happen, and I think they're just working out how these monsters interact and how they end up in the same realm with each other. If they can stick Captain America in a scene with Iron Man and Thor, I think you can definitely put Wolfman, Invisible Man, the Mummy, and Dracula in the same film as well." Okay, so real talk with Dracula Untold. Do I love this movie? No. Do I all caps hate this movie and think it is the worst thing I've ever seen in my life? No, I don't. I think it's blech. I don't want to see Dracula be a good guy. That's not what I signed up for. But, you know, it just, I didn't hate it like everybody else did. So, with that being said, Cody, I want to start with you. What are your thoughts on Luke Evans' Dracula possibly joining the bigger Universal Monsters universe?
Yeah, I wasn't crazy about Dracula Untold either. I thought, like, it's kind of if the MCU started out their universe with the Incredible Hulk. Like, it's kind of just like a whatever, you know? It's fine. It's serviceable. I'm just confused as what this big mashup movie, if they release, like, what it's going to be. Like, the Avengers makes sense because they're all fighting the big bad guy. But what are all these bad guys going to be doing together? All these Universal villains, you know?
Yeah.
I'm kind of confused.
No, that's a good question. I mean, we don't really know what the end game would be in theory. So, Perri, how about you? Now, here's a question. Did you see Dracula Untold?
I was actually on the set of that movie,
great,
too.
So you know about all the changes. Like,
a lot of changes.
Yeah.
On set, that movie sounded and looked like the coolest, most innovative thing you could imagine for a Dracula movie. a good deal of that was stripped out of the movie. And, you know, we couldn't even run some of our set visit because, I mean, such drastic changes where things were done there on set, finished, sets built, and then they weren't included in the movie.
Really? Wasn't there a witch character that was complete? So she is on the DVD, I believe.
Oh, really?
I think so, because when
that
I was...
That was the main thing that I was never allowed to talk about.
Okay, well... Well, now I feel weird. Well, because, no, I...
It's a knock at a door. It's Universal.
Yeah, Universal. Hold on. Excuse me.
They're coming to get me 3-4 years later.
Yeah. Well, no, the reason I bring this up is because I... So I had the pleasure of going to Romania on behalf of the Blu-ray release for this, and they took us on this very big, widespread trip learning all about Vlad the Impaler, which was very interesting. That's not important. What is important is that they showed us on the bus a DVD was playing, and it was behind-the-scenes stuff because it was for the Blu-ray release, and it was the director showing these scenes and providing audio commentary about this whole subplot of a witch that completely got stripped out, I think to bring in Charles Dance, if I'm not mistaken.
I don't know if that was the reason that it was taken out, but that was the witch was Baba Yaga, and I'm trying to find the actress's name who was playing her from Les Mis, which is escaping me, but they had built this really cool, almost like a Hansel and Gretel witch type house where it looked really beautiful on the outside and the house would stand up on little chicken legs and move around.
Oh, that's awesome.
It might sound ridiculous when I'm explaining it, but we saw concept art for it and it looked absolutely incredible. Her costumes looked incredible. And then
she was gone.
Completely gone. I felt really bad too because, you know, she had just come off Les Mis. She was trying to like make a name for herself. She gets this big studio production and then just like poof.
Sure. Gone.
But back to Luke Evans. I didn't hate the movie either. And I like him. I do generally like him in everything he's in. I don't think I've ever seen a movie where he's such a standout where I'm like, oh, next big thing. Focus on him. He could, I don't know, win an Oscar down the line. I don't look at him like that, but I think in the role of Dracula in this movie, he was probably perfect casting for it. However, at this point, I mean, obviously there are going to be talks to have him involved. I wouldn't be surprised if there was really surface level conversations. I don't know how serious those talks are. And I don't know if Universal really knows what they're doing with the Monster Cinematic Universe either. They're probably going to wait until one, if not two of these movies comes out and then be like, oh, let's call Luke and see if this whole big mashup movie is even possible, because I don't even know if it's going to move past one or two movies. Is there really a market for this?
So that's a good point.
Yeah.
What were you going to say? I didn't mean to interrupt you.
No, I was just going to say remains to be seen what these, if it will end up in a team-up picture a la Avengers, or if the first one out of the gate, The Mummy, crashes and burns and it affects the universe. I can't put my head around it. What I will say is I don't think Luke Evans is coming back. I think it's great that they're talking to him. I think they should. However, if you look at the casting of Johnny Depp as the Invisible Man, Tom Cruise, we have Russell Crowe. Who else has been cast lately?
Javier
Bardem. Look at these actors for their universe, that a shared universe. Look at how Dracula Untold crashed and burned here stateside. It's not going
to
happen.
Okay, so I put it to you guys, because here's my thoughts on this.
Yeah.
Okay, Universal likes Luke Evans because he's in their Fast and Furious movies. That's step one. Step two is he's about to be Gaston in the live-action Beauty and the Beast movie.
Ooh, that's a good
Luke
point.
Luke Evans is about to be on everyone's radar. And so I'm wondering if maybe they're playing the long game here and going, look, Luke Evans has been showing up in a bunch of stuff. We like him. He gets these big roles. But by the time we're ready to reintroduce Dracula, he's going to be in probably one of the biggest movies of the year at that point, being a tough, scary, like, you know, whatever kind of guy. Will they maybe try and hold on to him because of that?
That's probably why conversations like this are why conversations like these are happening right now. But I don't know, when you think about some of the other Disney live action movies, is anyone really talking about Lily James right now on the level of a Tom Cruise? Luke Evans still feels like a funny fit to me.
Sure, that's fair.
Amongst that group. But yeah, that's not to say he's any less of an actor than they are.
And well, the part of Gaston that you bring up, it is potential to be a scene stealer. So let's see if he comes out and everybody's talking about Luke Evans. But again, I think they want to erase the bad taste in our mouth with Dracula Untold. So I think personally, I didn't like the movie at all. The movie's awful, in my opinion. You got to start over. And it's Dracula. We're talking, he's the Spider-Man of the Avengers. He is Dracula. He's the most popular. This is my opinion. You could argue Frankenstein or whatnot, but Dracula, to me, is always the main bad guy in this Wolfman, Frankenstein, yeah. Invisible Man. It's Dracula. He's our guy, right? Start over. Go out. Get your Johnny Depp, your Tom Cruise, your Russell Crowe, whoever it may be. That's where I think they're going. I think this is... I don't know. The mythology in Dracula Untold is very confusing yeah. as well, so you could possibly use him because I know he takes on the name Dracula by the time we get there, but he's not... I don't know. It's confusing. I just don't think they're going to go
I'm
there.
Pretty sure that end tag was made for this purpose. Yes. It was added after the fact so that yeah. later on that they could then loop him in with these other characters. So
we'll see, everybody. But I like your point, Cody, about like starting the Marvel Universe with the Incredible Hulk.
Exactly. Yeah, right.
Like, no,
great
that's
point.
Not like, how that works.
They swung for the fences, but it was still kind of like a whimper with Dracula and Tony. Yeah. I don't know, you know?
No, that's a very valid point. Well, we shall see. Okay, let's move on from one legendary bad guy to another. Those of you looking for updates on the Texas Chainsaw Massacre origin story, Leatherface from Inside and Levied directors Julian Murray and Alexandra Bustillo have a tiny little nugget courtesy of Bloody Disgusting, who have reported that the MPAA has given the movie an R rating for strong bloody violence, disturbing images, language, and some sexuality / nudity. Now, while this should come as a shock to no one, come on, it is the origin story of Leatherface, what is interesting is that the movie is complete and has been evaluated by the MPAA at all. Now, while fans still have not gotten more than a teaser poster and anxiously await a trailer and a release date, Bloody Disgusting, who has been getting information from the shoot throughout the entire process, also notes that the movie underwent heavy reshoots fairly recently. Leatherface stars Jessica Madsen, Stephen Dorff, and Lily Taylor, and is described by the directing team as a brutal and nihilistic road movie that we hope will surprise and delight fans. Okay, Mark Reilly, I put it to you. What the hell is going on with Leatherface?
I bet you hope it surprises and delights fans because we're getting... What do I talk about all the time here? My favorite, Jason, getting an origin story. When I heard about Leatherface getting an origin story, I was... Again, I'm going to... Go home, Leatherface. You're drunk. Okay? I'm just... I don't want this movie. I don't want it. So then I hear reshoots and reshoots and reshoots. Okay, so fine. The MPAA has given it a rating, R-rated. Great. Let me see a trailer. I mean, I'm very hard on it because I love Texas Chainsaw Massacre so much. And you could argue maybe part two is pretty out there fun with Dennis Hopper. But from there, aside from the remake, which I thought was really well done, I haven't liked any of the other movies. Even the prequel remake, I didn't like that movie that much. So this just, to me, again, is just more origin story. Okay, just the branding. It's Leatherface. Okay. I hope it's a nihilistic horror movie that's disgusting and shocks me and delights me, but I don't have a lot of faith.
All right, that's fair. Now, Perri, I know nothing gives you the giggles like Leatherface chasing people around.
Texas Chainsaw 3D. I got so many people tweeting that gif at me of her
so
just like
funny.
Running in. It really is funny, though.
Yeah.
If you haven't seen it yet, please go look that up.
All right, so what do you think is going on here? I mean, like, you know, the idea this movie has been done for a while. These directors are really acclaimed French directors. You know, horror fans love them. They are known for their brutality. They are known
Good.
For going for
Good.
It. So they seemed like the perfect choice to begin. I mean, what do you think is happening? Can you believe the movie's done and we've seen nothing?
That makes me pretty damn nervous. I mean, we're constantly saying don't freak out when you hear the words reshoot because that isn't necessarily a bad thing. Most of the time, production's budget for a reshoot. It's meant to be. It's meant to make the movie better. It's a good thing. Based on what I'm hearing with this, that it's done and we haven't seen anything in heavy reshoots, I don't know, I'm a little concerned. I'm also concerned because I don't like the synopsis for this movie
Ooh,
at
interesting.
All. It sounds like it basically sounds like the anti-Texas Chainsaw Massacre movie that I would have wanted at this point. I don't know why I'm first doing this research and coming to learn all these details, but there was a poster revealed for this early September, and I forget what the tagline is, but the tagline was awful and just reading
something about the face of evil, I think, or something like. If I'm making that up,
something
I might
about
something
it
like
didn't
that.
Make sense. It was like the origin of him and like the face of evil and blah blah blah. And I'm just looking at the names of the character. Like Lily Taylor is credited as Verna Sawyer, so Leatherface's grandmother.
Yeah.
And You know, I don't know how they're going to make that work and make me buy a backstory like this. And also because the way it's presented, you have four inmates and one of them is Leatherface. No.
You don't like that? No. I kind of love that.
Is it like
that.
A mystery? Like yeah. A third act twist where they're going to reveal it?
You figure out who it really is? Cody's not
for
on board
whole,
either.
Like, 90-minute movie, I don't know if I can stand that. I just don't understand why this movie's, why an origin story of Leatherface is even happening. I can't think of any time recently where an origin story of an iconic horror character actually worked. So mm-hmm. I don't understand. And the word reshoots just gives me a headache every time I hear it now.
Yeah.
So.
There's also a character in there named Ted Hardesty, which worries me.
Why?
Sally's
something? Right. Yes. They're connected.
I hope to God that she wasn't there for that kind of reason.
If only John Schnepp were here, he would go on a rampage about how he is so not on board with tying it all together. Oof. And
oh,
I know,
man.
I mean,
yeah.
Okay, so our panel is not excited about this.
When does this come out? Is it like
we don't know? No release date, no official trailer. I believe the poster that came out was actually for the sales market. You know, when they go to the international distribution market. I think that's the only reason why that poster even saw the light of day. Oh. If I'm not mistaken, I could be wrong. But okay, well,
for the record, though, so the tagline on this poster is. Witness the beginning of your end. Oh, I hate it already. The origin story of the Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
There you go.
Nope.
Okay.
Why?
Nope.
Why?
Well,
why?
Sorry, Leatherface. We're not on board, I suppose. But, you know, maybe, look, the directors are what is making me kind of still curious about this. So we'll find out.
Look, there's always a first, right? So maybe this is the one where we get an origin story that actually makes sense and actually makes us happy. I'm always open to it, right? But I just, yeah. Damn,
right.
Origin stories.
Well, this is depressing. Let's move on to good news. We do have some today in Fresh Meat. We sure do. So while we've been hearing rumblings for a little while now, the directing trio that makes up RKSS Films have officially announced that Turbo Kid 2 is a go. Woohoo! They're keeping plot details quiet, of course, but Anakwasel did reveal that it will be a direct sequel to the first film. Now, for those who are unfamiliar, Turbo Kid is the indie favorite that takes place in a post-apocalyptic wasteland and sees a comic book fan who dons the persona of his favorite hero to save his enthusiastic friend and fight a tyrannical overlord. In addition to this bit of exciting information, a music video prequel to the franchise hit the web from RKSS Films team. No Tomorrow shows the story that leads into Apple's first meeting with the kid. All right, Perri, I know you are jazzed about this.
I love Turbo Kid.
Now, for you guys at home, Turbo Kid is streaming instantly on Netflix, and it is one of a kind. It's so weird and cool and great, and it's worth a watch, so go for it. So, Perri, you're excited.
It was a huge, huge surprise to me. I didn't think that this was going to be my kind of thing, and I had seen it on a screener from Sundance last year, the year before, so I watched it by myself at home, and I had a lot of fun with it, but then I went to South By, and I wanted to see it again with a midnight audience, and perfect midnight screening movie. Just, you know, go put this movie on, have a drink, get some friends together, and just have some fun. This world is just so interesting and colorful to me, and just like crazy. I was gonna curse and stop myself. But this is just a lot of fun, and this movie has amassed such a fan base since it came out because I covered it nonstop. I followed their Instagram account and just the things that they've shared on that account over the years. Just, you know, fans sending in drawings, fans doing cosplay. It really just goes to show how much this movie excited and kind of touched people too. And I'm just a big fan of the kid that plays the main character, the kid, Monroe Chambers. And the thought of doing a direct sequel where it's him exploring the wasteland. Yeah, I'll watch that for another 90 minutes with crazy gore and like heads getting chopped off and all that good stuff. I love this.
All right, so Cody, I know you haven't seen the film yet,
no.
But as a fan of film in general, does it kind of give you hope for the future that these little weird cult genre films are not only finding an audience, but getting budgets to actually go further and get sequels?
Absolutely, this sounds freaking awesome. Like I haven't seen the first movie and everyone yells at me for it, but just hearing you describe it and hearing you being so happy about it. I'm going to go home and watch it on the first one on Netflix. This sounds incredible. I'm telling you. Yeah.
Yes. All right, Mark Reilly, how about you? I mean, even, you know, it kind of speaks to the power of the fan, right? The idea that, you know, the little movie that could, it gets critical acclaim, and also it's different. You know, we're here talking about prequels and origin stories and all of this nonsense, and here comes this really weird thing that people love, and now we're getting more of.
I love this. Same. Haven't seen it. Missed my radar completely. But then in the research, I pull up the poster and I'm like, yeah, I'm about that poster. I love this poster. I'm looking at it now. And so hearing you guys talk about it so highly, praising it so highly, I'm in. I got to watch it too, just like you, Cody. So to answer your question, I'm so glad that these little independent, quirky movies find an audience at a midnight screening where they're yelling and screaming and cheering. This is what we want out of a movie. So this, now I gotta go see it. So very exciting. I'm glad to see a sequel happening based on everybody's reaction who's seen it.
Well, we all have a date with Netflix later tonight. Let's all watch Turbo Kid again tonight.
I am totally fine with that. And RKSS, the trio that directed the movie, they're just a delightful bunch. And they're clearly so excited and happy to bring this kind of material to people. And I feel like you could really feel that energy when you watch the movie.
You know what I think we should do? We should do a Collider Nightmares live tweet of Turbo Kid.
Be a lot of fun.
I'm down.
Let's do that. Okay, you heard it here first. I'm gonna organize this because we all have so much time and stuff. But we're done. We're doing this. A live tweet of Turbo Kid. I will have a date for you next week. How about that? If you can
wait.
Yeah.
It's happening. I can't wait.
It's happening, y'all.
Rock and roll.
Okay, and now that I have an assignment, let's move on to our favorite thing to yell into the microphone. What's in the box?
What's in the box? What's in the box? What's on the box? It's your divorce papers.
Yes, it sure is.
Oh. That's what's in there.
That's what's in the box. Sorry.
Sick burn, Mark Reilly. Sick burn. Okay, so first up, Westworld. You are finally here. Yeah. The ambitious new science fiction drama premiered on HBO on Sunday night, and boy, does this show have a lot of promise. Obviously, TV Talk has talked about it, but they're not Collider Nightmares. We are, damn it. So we're going to talk about it now. We've all seen it. We all watched it. I actually got the opportunity to watch this with an audience on a big screen at Fantastic Fest, which was super cool, and they gave us chili provided by HBO. So thank you, HBO, for that chili. Yep, that was pretty cool. What I'm saying is my opinion might have been tainted by this delightful chili. I'm just kidding. The show is incredible, but I think what's cool about it, the one thing I wanted to interject before we sort of start talking is, I don't think this is a show that we should try to get in front of. I think it's like really tempting for us as viewers to try and figure everything out before, you know, like you look at the pilot and you go, oh, I know where this is going, or this is going here, and these predictions. And I think that this is going to be a show that, yes, probably has a lot of surprises, but also is just more about the universe. It's about that world, and it's kind of inviting you to like settle in, because we're all going to be in this for a while. But guys, you know, please feel free to jump in. Any initial reactions?
Oh my God. I loved this episode. I absolutely loved it. And what I loved is halfway through being so confused as to what the hell was going on, and kind of what you're alluding to, Clark, settling in. And I noticed myself settling in and going, this whole team behind Westworld has got my back. We're going to make sure that you, like, I just really was discovering this story, filling in the blanks towards the end and going, oh, okay. Loving the all the elements with the fly and what that meant throughout it. There's the fly just pops up all over, where you can kind of see who's an android and who's not, but then seeing the evolution of it towards the end there. I was blown away by how much, like, maybe it's in the way our pop culture is with movies and television, where you get everything right away in the trailer, so you know, so you're not surprised, and being a little frustrated being that I couldn't figure it out right away, and then finally settling in and going, okay, they got me. I'm enjoying this. It was great. I can't wait to see the next episode.
And I think it's also the kind of thing where we'll all look back at the pilot and kind of be like, oh, that's, you know, you'll see so much. It'll kind of unravel as the season goes on. But how about this side of the panel? What are your initial impressions?
This, to me, is how you adapt something to a new medium.
Yeah.
Flipping the viewpoint from the humans to the robots. And it's so interesting. And I will echo what you said. There's some confusion there, but it's good confusion because this is a show and this is a pilot that didn't spell everything out, but it slowly gave you enough information so that you fully understood what Westworld was, what the humans are meant to do in there, what the robots are meant to do, what's going on behind the scenes. You do get all the pieces to the puzzle, but with much more left to be discovered. I am just so into this, and I'm so curious to see where they go from there. Also because some of those, you know, those reports, the crazy reports about what they made the cast do.
Right.
So I'm curious to see how they go in terms of all that nonsense, but... The performances here, I think, are great. I'm really excited for Evan Rachel Wood leading a show like this. And just the fact that it's like I hear so many people asking, oh, is this the new Game of Thrones? Is this what's going to carry HBO to the next step when that show's gone in two seasons? But it's so incredibly different. It does seem like a grand scale, expensive production that, you know, is willing to be daring in certain respects as compared to other shows that are out there. But this is... This to me, and I'm a big fan of Game of Thrones. I don't mean to put Game of Thrones down when I'm saying this. I just don't know how else to articulate it. But this is such a thoughtful show. Just the whole idea of exploring how these robots are, like, are they equal to humans? Because clearly they see and feel, and
there's a philosophy to this world.
I'm really looking forward to digging into that element of the show, which that's something that I don't think very many shows out there dare touch upon right now.
Absolutely. I think this is a really cerebral show. I think, you know, yes, you can get the visceral of the cowboys and the violence and the explosions and the sex and all of these things, good guys and bad guys and robots and technology and future and past and all of these things, but there's also really existential questions that are being asked. Cody, what were some of your reactions?
I thought it was pretty cool. I love the world that was set up, and I just think it's so interesting that, like, you see essentially the same simulation throughout the entire episode, but you see all these different points of view of it, and it's just so cool. And I love what you were saying earlier about not getting ahead of it, because like, I hate when people just come up with all these theories, because most of the time you're wrong. Sorry, and you're just almost always disappointed because it wasn't where you thought you were gonna. Is going to go. So I love what this show's setting up right now. I just can't wait. It's great.
Yeah, I'm really excited too. And I don't know if you guys saw the season teaser that played after the, so it was just a preview of basically what's to come that season, which is pretty typical after the first episode.
I was purposely avoiding it.
Yeah, I didn't watch it either. Yeah.
It's the downside of watching a screener.
You didn't see it either.
It doesn't come with that tacked on.
Oh. Yeah, no, it's on there with my HBO Now, but I turned it off. That speaks on the experience I had with the pilot. Just being so surprised, I was like, I really want to know what, like, the next episode, I really want to go in blind as much as possible.
Well, I'm pretty sure the second we wrap, I'm going to go watch it now.
Go in blind if that's how you, if you prefer. I think that's a great way.
It's a new thing for me. Because that's what I was feeling in the middle of watching it, where I was just like, oh my God, what are they doing? Oh, I'm confused. And then the payoff by the end of it was just like, ooh, all right.
Well, I think the little bit that this small introduction that you get to every single character, right? Because there's a lot of character, there's a lot of world in this first episode. What you see in this preview for the season, it just, because if I felt a little scattered or a little kind of like overwhelmed by the pilot, which I did, there's a lot to take in there. Watching the preview for the whole season, I thought to myself, oh my God, I am so on board for this. I want to see. And also, it's kind of cool because, you know, we've seen these characters die, obviously. We've seen them die over and over and over again. So when you see them die in previews or things coming up, what does that even mean?
Yeah.
It doesn't mean anything, or does it? So, Westworld airs on Sunday nights on HBO, and boy, what a cool show.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
So, thumbs up. All right. So, let's move on to another really cool-sounding show that also involves a very big world. Now, if you're a fan of the Purge films, or even if you just think the premise is good, you've probably had the same thought I have, which is, geez, this should either be an anthology or a TV show. Well, when you think about it, there's so much story, and you can compare Purge Nights. Yeah, when you think about it, you can compare Purge Nights from the first year or the 10th year in a big city, in a conventional suburb, in a rural small town. So good news, guys. According to franchise creator James DeMonico, we are finally getting our wish, if you're like me and that is your biggest wish, which it is. DeMonico told CinemaBlend's Eric Eisenberg, and he explained that the series is not quite an anthology. It's more of an interwoven anthology. They came to me about a TV show, and my idea is you do 6 or 7 storylines, and it would kind of intercut them and use flashbacks. He continued saying, the idea of why I like the idea of maybe a 10-hour thing on this is it's the one thing you can't really do in films. Just because of mere real estate or time, you can't get into the nuance and complexity that would drive someone to commit a terrible act on this night, whether it's revenge or out of passion. But what might be interesting in a TV show with a flashback narrative, if you start on Purge night, but you go back to show how people have gotten to where they are, where you see a couple that's gone haywire on this night, but let's show everything that led up to that moment of a husband trying to kill his wife, the cheating or the accusations of cheating or the money problems. It would be interesting to show those arcs, those dramatic and complex arcs that get people to where they are to pick up a gun or a knife and kill someone else. I think there's something cool we can do with the real estate of TV, 10 hours potentially. You guys, I love this so much. So, okay, you know, I said it a bit in the intro, kind of jumbled because I went off script and that's why I shouldn't do that. But it's such, The Purge is such a great idea. Now, I love the first movie. I know I'm in the minority there, but I think that what we've seen over the last 3 films are, you know, I just always want to see more. I want to see different stories. I want a different world every single time. That's my hope for it, because exactly what James said, there's so much potential here to tell compelling and stories and really get to the bottom of what horror really is. Why is it scary? Well, it's the people you know that turn on you. That's what's scary. So, Cody, I want to start with you. Are you a fan of the Purge franchise, and do you like the idea of expanding it into a TV show?
Yeah, for me, the Purge movies are kind of hit and miss. Not like you, sorry. I did not like the first movie a lot at all. But the second one I thought really redeemed it. And then I haven't seen the third one yet. But for this as a TV show, it's interesting. Are they saying like each season is going to be one night and then they're going to be different viewpoints? Or is it all going to be one night and then all the seasons are going
to
be one?
I think it's kind of up in the air, to be honest with you. Yeah. I think he's open to maybe doing a different person in every season. Okay. Or
I read that quote like 10 times to try to figure that out.
It was confusing.
Yeah. It's confusing. I think what I ended up settling on was that maybe he meant that we were going to explore what different people were doing on one Purge night per season. But like that's just me guessing.
Okay, interesting. Well, I'm down either way. I'm with you where you're saying like the Purge is such a great idea, and I remember when it was announced and I saw the first trailer, I was like, that could go either really great or really bad. And it turned out, you know, exactly how I thought it was going to. So I'm hoping this redeems itself. For it. Yeah.
That's fair. All right, Mark Reilly, now how about you? Would you tune into a Purge TV show?
Yes, and I'm going off of the last bits of comments that he made. What makes a person decide to pick up a knife or a gun on the night that you can actually kill people? I think that is fascinating. And I think it really sounds much better to, on TV than the movies, especially with so much wonderful television out there. We have your HBOs, your Showtimes, your streamings, your Amazon, anything. This could go there and really push the bounds of television. I could see it on Netflix as a really hardcore horror kind of feel to it. I could see it at HBO. I think it should avoid your Fox or your ABCs or your CBS. I don't think that's the place for it. I see FX, AMC. It's very, very exciting. Getting in the head. You're in a small rural town and you're dealing with domestic violence within a family, and what happens on the one night of the year that you can do this. That is fascinating to me. So I am so on board with this.
Yeah, I'm excited too. Perri, what are your thoughts?
I'm with you. I'm a big fan of the first Purge movie, and I think that part of the reason so many people didn't like the first one and they liked the second one was just like a matter of advertising. They had presented it like this big concept, and then all of a sudden you're stuck in this one house with this one family. And I did not like it the first time I saw it. Then it grew on me. And now that we have the Purge Anarchy and the Purge election year, I've come to appreciate that movie more because it focuses on one family and their story and their relationship and what happens when they just happen to be up against this crazy group of people who want to participate in Purge night, plus some. But I love the idea of doing this. One of my favorite interviews that I've ever done is with James DeMonico for the Purge Anarchy, just because this is a concept that you could talk to death over. There's just so many possibilities. I still think the way to go, and I actually think he also gave CinemaBlend some quotes about this too, for the Purge 4, going back to, you know, the founding fathers and why the Purge came to be. So I don't know if this TV show would then affect the possibility of a Purge 4, but I always liked the idea of going back to the beginning and, you know, what state was the country in that we needed this on the day that they instituted this policy. But I like the idea of doing a TV show and exploring it through flashbacks what makes someone want to kill on Purge Night. However, given the direction they're going with Anarchy and Purge Election Year, and how successful those movies are, it is becoming less and less about like a human story on Purge Night, and it's much more so about crazy Halloween costumes and that damn candy bar girl who drives me off my
mind.
You
and that candy bar girl every day.
I'm telling you, when you see the Purge Election Year, let's talk candy bar girl. She's the worst. But it's just become more about showiness and less about
substance,
humanity and substance and all that. So I just wonder if this would even appeal to the Purge fans that have made this franchise so much money over the years.
It's a great question. I mean, the franchise has made so much money over the years. You have to imagine that it is it's a wide amount of people, right? But who knows? I'm so on board with this. This is what I've been begging for since this first sequel was announced. And I get that they need to go in. It's fun to go in an action exploitation kind of way, but I like the cerebral aspect.
I hope they explore other things you can do on Purge Night too, because that's a question
all
that comes.
All crime is legal.
That's a question
right?
that comes up every single time
Absolutely.
A Purge movie comes out. If someone will ask me, what would you do on Purge Night? Like, no, I would not kill someone. I'd go rob an Apple store because I like their computers. That's
totally.
What I would do. So I want to see what someone else would do other than killing on Purge
Night. I'll come with you on that. Yeah.
I'll just go jaywalking. That's what I'm gonna do.
You rebel, you.
Live it up.
Slow down, Cody.
I'm sorry.
All right, and finally, when it comes to horror comedies, we all know that they can be hard to get right. One of the fan favorites over the last few years was the New Zealand comedy What We Do in the Shadows, starring Jemaine Clement and Taika Waititi. It was a documentary-style movie that followed a group of vampire roommates and their silly adventures. Hmm. Now, while a sequel titled Werewolves, which follows the foul-mouthed werewolves, is in the works, we now learned that a TV series that takes place in that same universe will be headed to New Zealand airwaves. A few weeks back, Clement had mentioned that he had pitched a TV series called Police 10-7 that, according to Empire Online, would focus on the film's easily manipulable police officers, Mike and Karen. Now, even though Clement thought that the chances of the pitch going to series were slim, the series is a go under a new title, Event Response Unit. We will see Mike and Karen protecting Wellington from the supernatural. The order includes 6 half-hour episodes, but we have no confirmation on who will air the series outside of New Zealand. Perri,
how could I ever say no to this?
I don't know.
Anything What We Do in the Shadows related, I will watch it. Going with these two cops is not the route that I thought that they would go for, you know, whether it's a sequel or a TV series, but I don't care. As long as the original creators are involved and the tone and the style stays the same or similar, I'm all for it. Just preparing for this show and going back and just watching some scenes with the two cops, I just fell into that black hole of just bumping from clip to clip. And I'm pretty sure I just watched the whole movie out of sequence this morning. So if you haven't seen What We Do in the Shadows, it is a must. Go check it out.
I'm hearing Reno 911 meets Supernatural.
That's what I was going to say. Yeah. Okay. Reno 911, yeah.
So exactly. What do you think?
I'm so excited for this. What We Do in the Shadows is one of the funniest movies I've seen in a long time. And I love that they're like, this expands the world so much to where they can, it's not just vampires and werewolves. You can maybe have them go up zombies and ghost stuff. All that, the tone of the movie can fit in so many different ways. I can't wait for this. This sounds great.
Riley?
I just need lots of cameos from the past movies. This is great. Yeah, I finally caught the movie. And so I think this is a nice progression into like X-Files, Reno 911, all of that, you know, just shake it on up and give us gloriousness. This sounds so much fun. So, how can you say no to this? I cannot say no to this. It made me smile just thinking about it. So.
I can't say no either. And it is a go. It's happening. Like 6 episodes have been ordered, which is
right
fabulous.
On.
And like I said, we don't know who's going to show it outside of New Zealand, but I have a feeling that someone like Netflix or Amazon or the like will be quick to pick it up.
I hope so. Given the popularity of the movie and how, like, because when it came out, wasn't it a nothing thing, and all of a sudden it took off and then got an expansion
there
or whatnot?
There was a Kickstarter. The release was really bizarre with What We Do in the Shadows. I remember people seeing it at festivals and saying, oh my God, it's so funny. But the release relied on a Kickstarter element for some reason, and it was kind of weird how it all rolled out. But that's what digital digital is for. Yay. Okay, so now, even though Mr. John Schnepp is not here with us in person, he's here with you in the TV right now watching you. Yes, John Schnepp spoke with David Hartman and Don Coscarelli in honor of Phantasm Ravager, Phantasm movie in the franchise. That is on VOD right now. So let's take a look at a piece of their conversation.
Let's talk about Phantasm Ravager. How did Phantasm, the fifth Phantasm, come about? Let's start with you, Don.
Well, it came about when Phantasm 4 ended, because I thought that Phantasm 4 was a nice conclusion to the series and sort of wrapped it up. But then I started getting a lot of emails and reading a lot of posts, which was always, where's number five? And I'm thinking, oh, wow, they actually want another part five. So for a few years, I sort of let it go because I just had no clue as how to do it. And in the interim, I made Bubba Hotep, and then I had worked with David Hartman. And what I really admired about Dave was that he and his pack of filmmaking friends loved to make narrative shorts every weekend. Maybe they'd get a new piece of software, they'd go out and try it, and they would make these really inventive, you know, and I saw the Channel 101 movies, like the Laser Fart series was awesome with Dan Harmon. Those things were epic. And so one day Dave comes to me and he just goes, Don, next weekend, let's go out and make a Phantasm short. And I'm thinking, hey, that'd be a lot of fun, you know? Maybe we could put it on the web, the fans might enjoy it, what have you. So I called up Reggie Bannister, the star of the series, and I said, Reg, I met this really inventive guy, and he wants to go out and shoot a Phantasm short this weekend. You want to come? And he says, yeah, man, I'm down. Let's do it. And so we actually went up to where Reggie lived, up near Big Bear there in the mountains, and shot a weekend, and I had so much fun because, number one, not directing it, the pressure was off. So I could work on the lighting and some camera and some of the blood effects. I could be splattering blood, the fun stuff, right? Making a movie with a crew of about four or five, you know, good friends, and with Dave at the helm. And it turned out so well that a couple weekends later, we went back and did another one. And pretty soon I'm looking at these scenes, and then Dave, of course, has this visual ability, you know, not only as an artist, but as a visual effects artist, you know, and he's starting to put, you know, these type of images where he's, you know, a giant sphere ideas and what have you. And so I just decided, you know, let's just go for it. Dave, you're directing Phantasm 5. let's figure out a script to tie in what we've shot and to make a complete film.
They are just the best. Don Coscarelli's a dreamboat. I love him. So Phantasm Ravager is available today. And don't forget that the original Phantasm, the OG, the one that started it all, has been restored by J.J. Abrams' company, Bad Robot. And it is also available. Guys, this is a huge thing. It has been so hard to find Phantasm for so long. And now you can finally see it in all of its 4K glory. All right. And also thank you to Don and David for coming in, because hello, you guys are awesome. Okay, so let's move on. Now we've got a new segment for you guys. It is October. It is Halloween month. Yes. We're so, so excited. And with that comes a bunch of activities and movies that remind us of the reason for the season. So this week, we're going to introduce something new here, our own personal kill lists.
Yes.
And these are lists intended to give you recommendations so that you can get into the Halloween spirit. Big props to Ray, who made that amazing graphic.
Perfect.
So first up, since we spend so much time talking about horror movies and how they aren't as good as they used to be, not true, this week the panel is going to give you three of their favorite movies from the aughts, or since the year 2000. Now, I told everybody to pick three because I knew we would say more than just three. So get your notepads ready, get your bloody notebook situated.
Yeah.
See, right up there, and get ready to write them down. All right, guys, so who wants to start with some of their favorite movies in the year 2000?
Oh, I'll go then. All everybody right, look Ellie. To me. I'll do this.
Go for it.
I mean, first off, you didn't stress me out by having me pick three. Just three?
I know.
I went through, I'm counting at least 25 that I put down that I had to then go back and star. So taking the fact that it's Halloween, I wanted to do classic Halloween, feel-good Halloween movie, as well as something that scares you, and there's something that just inherently to me is a scary movie that is just so much fun to watch on Halloween. So the first one on that is The Conjuring, the original.
Good choice.
Love it. It's one of my favorite horror movies. It's getting in there. It's in the top 10. I think it's one of those ghost story, haunted house movies that is just so well done. Love it, love it, love it. Then something that scared the bejesus out of me, The Babadook. Go see The Babadook. This is something that you will put on, have your friends there, get some popcorn, carve some pumpkins, and watch this thing because it's going to just freak you out. And I was so impressed by this. And then a classic now for the Halloween season, do it right the night before or the night of, Trick or Treat. You got to do Trick or Treat. It might be on everybody's list here, but those are my three. I love this game. I love the kill list. Let's keep doing this.
Yeah. All right, guys. Who wants to go next?
All right. I'll just get it over with. This was hard because I ended up with this massive list. I managed to narrow it down to 8 that I was pretty confident in, but obviously I had to pick 3. I'm going to start with what you just said, which is Trick or Treat, because I basically narrowed it down by what I watched most often. And Trick or Treat has been not just a Halloween tradition, but I watch it quite frequently throughout the year. And I used to just love when FearNet used to do the 24-hour marathon. That's just one that never gets old. I can watch it over and over. Love that movie. Then I'm going to go something pretty new that I've watched too many times this year already, which is Green Room. It's still my number one movie of 2016. I can't even explain why I'm obsessed with it. I can't stop watching it. It's the movie that I've seen the most of all the 2016 releases, and I own it, and I'm going to keep watching it. And then I'm also going to give a shout out to one of my favorite franchises out there and say the first Final Destination movie.
Nice.
And I love almost every single Final Destination movie except for the Final Destination. That's the 3D one where I feel like everything in the movie was made for 3D and not just to be a good movie in and of itself, but the first two in particular are really damn good. The first Final Destination, I watch it all the time. The second one also with the highway opening scene. So, all right, so I kind of cheated here. A little shout out to the Final Destination and the Final Destination 2. I love those movies, love that franchise, and I kind of still dream of the day where we get another one.
Yeah, good. All right, work the system. All right, Cody, what do you got?
Here we go. My first one's The Conjuring. For all the reasons Riley said, for me, it's my favorite horror movie of the last 15 years. It's just fantastic. Best demon possession movie in a while.
Yeah.
Next up is The Ring, obviously.
Good
it's
choice.
A great one. I love that movie.
There you go.
And then my last one here, I'm going to get some crap for this probably, but The First Paranormal Activity.
Yeah.
Scared the living crap out of me
with
when
you.
I
Like, that would be my honorable mention.
Absolutely. Yeah, that movie kept me up for at least a couple days, I'll say. So, yeah, I got to throw that on there. Yeah.
Very good choices. All right, now I'm picked 3 that half of you guys are going to tell me I'm crazy. I decided to go ahead and pick 3 that I feel are unfairly maligned because I think they're good. And so I'm going to, what is it?
I don't know. I'm nervous.
You're nervous.
I am highly
don't be nervous.
Your answers
okay,
right now.
The first one is The Last Exorcism.
Yeah.
Nice. I love The Last Exorcism.
I do too. Yeah.
I think it is good. I think it is smart. I think it is creepy. And it makes found footage, I think it works for a documentary style. It's not really found footage, it's like documentary style. I think it is also the premise of a preacher, a priest who is a con man, I think is bold in the South where I'm from. I love horror movies that take place in the South. And the reveals, it's just all so smart. Now, I will say, I think the last 10 minutes are a total cop-out and a total bummer. However, I think the whole movie on its own absolutely is worth seeing. Next up, I'm going to go House of Wax. Yes, I said it. The remake.
Wow.
Yes.
Are you kidding?
Guys, let me tell you why.
Okay.
Let me tell you why. So you need to watch the House of Wax. Well, didn't our Conjuring friends write House of Wax?
They sure did.
They sure did.
Chad and Carrie Hayes,
So House of Wax, I think most people remember as the movie that Paris Hilton was in. Sure, right, okay. If you go back and watch it, it is, first of all, it's stunning. It's beautiful. They put so much money into this. This is Joel Silver's company. And you could tell this is a horror movie with a budget. The other element is, this is a movie that has so much weirdness going on beneath the surface. Yes, it is a body count movie, but when you look at the brother and sister relationship, they're just a little too close. And then you have another family element in there as well. And I think that it really holds up upon rewatching. So maybe give that a try. And then finally, this is going to get the biggest groan, but I don't care. Come at me, Lords of Salem.
Whoa.
I love Lords of Salem, you guys.
You lost me there.
That's fine. That's
you
okay.
Wow. Yeah.
I feel like Lords of Salem needs a little love, and I'll tell you why. Obviously, Rob Zombie has 31 coming out, and well, they already did like a day. Doesn't it come out in October for good?
I feel like it was available.
I was
at a
very
point.
Confused at their release with too. The yeah. one night fatter. Well, anyway, so Rob is very good at the Devil's Reject style thing, right? He's very good at the House of a Thousand Corpses thing, but I really think that he tried something different with Lords of Salem. I think this is a quiet film. I think it's a deliberate film, and I also love again the underlying message of addiction and somebody's soul being up for grabs. And I love the visuals. I love the soundtrack. I listen to that soundtrack sometimes and like the Weird Devil music comes on and I'm just like driving around in my car listening to Weird Devil music. But I love Lords of Salem and I think, you know, I think it's better than people give it credit for. So that's just what, 12 options for you guys. Come back next week because we will have more kill lists for you guys. A new topic with new panelists and it will be not new panelists but slightly different panelists and it'll be fun. And now let's get into your Twitter questions.
All right.
Tweet, 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 tweet. Okay. First up, guys, I don't know if you know this, but Collider Nightmares is, Ms. Perri Nemiroff leads a panel that has most of the Collider Nightmares team on it for the official Ash vs. Evil Dead after show.
Yeah, I mean, if you've heard us talk about this show at all on Collider Nightmares, you pretty much know that we're big fans of it. So it's really damn exciting to be able to call ourselves the official after show for Ash vs. Evil Dead. And that means we're going to get a whole bunch of exclusive materials. We're going to have interviews with the cast. It's going to be a lot of fun. And, you know, 9 more episodes to come. We already had an absolute blast on the first one. And wait until you see the second one. Oh. There's your tease right there.
Oh,
it's fun.
Boy.
It's weird. It's different. Only Ash can pull it off.
So with that being said, the first episode, Home, episode 201, is up right now on Collider Video, so you can watch it. So in honor of Ash vs. Evil Dead, Gil Castillo asks, how would you rank the Raimi Evil Dead movies? Army of Darkness is my favorite. This is a great question. Mm-hmm. I love this question. I'll go first. Actually, Army of Darkness was, I think, the first Evil Dead movie I saw. And I thought it was hilarious.
Yeah,
I really, really loved it. And so for me, I'm going to go backwards and say Army of Darkness, Evil Dead 2, Evil Dead.
Oh, wow. This is hard to do just because even though they're all part of the same franchise, they're all such different movies.
Yeah.
Very true.
I'm going to go number one, Evil Dead 2, because that to me is a good representation of what we get in Ash versus Evil Dead, just in terms of like high quality comedy and gore. Mm-hmm. And that probably speaks to me more so than anything, but it's not like I like Evil Dead or Army of Darkness any less. But then I'm going to go OG and say the original Evil Dead. That I started at the beginning and it was a shock to me how drastically different it was from Evil Dead to Evil Dead 2,
yeah.
And also how well that shift worked at the same time. And I think they pulled it off beautifully. And then Army of Darkness, which I absolutely love. It's batshit crazy, but it's a lot of fun.
Nice.
Perri said the S word.
Oh, no.
We did it.
You know what's funny?
We did it.
I'm pretty sure that was the word I stopped myself from saying earlier, too.
Your subconscious needs it out there.
She just had to curse. She just had to do it. What a bad girl. Bad Perri. Bad. Naughty, naughty.
Don't tell Dennis.
Who's next, gentlemen?
Go for it, Cody.
All right. Mine's the same as yours. It's Army of Darkness. I've seen that movie ton of times. That's my number one, obviously. Evil Dead 2, then Evil Dead. And I want to give an honorable mention. I know this doesn't count, but the remake, I think, was fantastic. And it doesn't get enough due. If Eddie Alvarez is the man, I can't wait to see where that guy goes.
So. Yeah.
Awesome. And Mark Reilly.
Well, I'm just going to... That guy was so fun. I wanted to hear everybody's because I was going back and forth on two. So I'm just going to go easy. 1, 2, 3.
Wow!
Evil Dead 1, because it set everything up. If I went back and watched it again probably about a year ago. And I just love it. And then I love what you said, Perri, how it shifts so kind of seamlessly into Evil Dead 2 as a parody sequel and becomes this what we know of Evil Dead. And then go batshit crazy. I brought batshit out to Army of Darkness, which is a comedy first and foremost for me. I love it so much. So yeah, 1, 2, 3, start there. That's how I know. When you said Army of Darkness, I flash back to watching Army of Darkness at my grandmother's, so I think I did too.
Wow.
I thought I did it in order, but I think you jogged a memory, so go
How'd
there.
How'd your grandma like the movie?
Oh, she loved it. Yeah, she loved it. Big Ash fan, yeah.
And finally, for our Twitter questions, Lucas asks, have you ever seen a horror movie that freaked you out so much that you refused to ever watch it again? This is a really good question. No, I think is the answer. However, I saw a movie at Fantastic Fest that, if you guys have read about it, you know. It's called We Are the Flesh. It's a Mexican horror film. This movie is just depraved, but it is... The director, I really believe, is a visionary. I mean, you know, for as over the top as all of the things in this crazy, crazy movie are, you know, he handles the way around the camera so well. And I have literally not stopped thinking about it for 2 weeks. Now, will I ever see it again? I'm gonna say no, probably not. I'm all set. But yeah, We Are the Flesh really stuck with me in all kinds of ways. So that's mine.
Well, I'll just say mine because it's easy and we've spoken about it before. It's Martyrs. That's pretty much the only horror movie I've ever seen that I will not put on ever again in my life. And if it's on in a room that I'm in, I will walk out or force someone to shut it off. It really upset me and rubbed me in all the wrong ways. I did not like it at all.
Fair. Nice. All right. Gentlemen.
You go for it.
All right. This is hard. I've been racking my brains. And so probably the answer is no. But the one that got very close, I've seen it twice. And it was hard the second time. So that's my The Hills Have Eyes.
Remake?
The remake.
Oh.
Really?
That's one of my faves.
I know it is. Awesome. I know it is. And I love it so much. I really do. It's a fantastic remake. But man, is it hard to watch for me.
Yeah, yeah.
Especially the way poor Ted goes. Ted Levine's character goes. That is something that is absolutely terrifying to watch. It is one of those movies that gets under my skin, so I'm not going to avoid it. If it's on, I'm going to watch it again probably. I just haven't gone after it again to watch it again because there's something in my head like that movie. When I watch it, I went, wow. Wow, does that get me?
It is relentless and brutal. All right, Cody, finish us off.
Close it out here with the most recent movie, I think, The Witch.
Ooh.
Now, I remember walking out of the theater kind of underwhelmed. I'm like, that wasn't really all that scary. But then I started thinking about it. And like, it kept me up that night. And I just started thinking of these creepy scenes. And then I have it on Blu-ray. I haven't gone back to watch it. I think it's still wrapped up. Like, it's just on my shelf. I can't bring myself to watch it again. It's a creepy movie.
You'll have to let me know when you do watch it again. Because for me, the second time I saw it, I was like, whoa. Really? I mean, it got me that much more. Because I walked out of the theater a little underwhelmed as well. And then the second time, I was floored. So keep me posted.
Okay.
And that's going to do it for us today. Now, guys, in case you missed it, there's a Schmodown where me and my partner over here went and played Team Heroes. None of them are here because they're scared.
That's right.
They're scared of us.
Totally scared.
Mm-hmm.
Totally scared.
And it is totally up on Collider Videos right now.
So intimidating.
Scary and stuff. And you can also watch the rest of John Schnepp's interview with Don Coscarelli and David Hartman right now on Collider Videos. And Perri, there's another thing on Collider Videos.
So you should check out our Not Scary Farm video. Last week we posted the Halloween Horror Nights one, and we're kind of trying to hit as many Halloween type events, haunted house type events, as we possibly can. And me and Mr. Mark Reilly over there, we went to Not Scary Farm, and we went through all the mazes, and we rode all the rides, and we had a lot of fun, and we made a video about it, so you should go check that out.
Wonderful. Yeah. All right, I want to thank my panel to my left, Ms. Perri Nemiroff. Where can they find you on the internet?
You guys can catch me on Twitter and Instagram at PNemiroff, right here on Collider Nightmares every Tuesday and every Saturday on Best of the Week.
And to her left, our wonderful special guest. Let's give him a round of applause. Where can they find you?
Stop it. So you guys can find me on Twitter at The Real Cody Hall, and check out the YouTube channel that I have my buddy Copster called Amateur Hour Films. We make a bunch of really ridiculous shorts, some of which are horror related. So
nice. Love it. And to my right, Mr. Mark Reilly.
You can find me at Reilly Around on Twitter and Instagram. You kind of know everything that I'm on, but I'm going to focus on one, and that's John Rocha.
Ooh.
I'm taking him on in the Schmodown this Friday. That's where I want you to focus, okay? Don't worry about any of the other nonsense going on. Just focus on the Schmodown, because John Rocha has probably the biggest mouth I have ever heard in my life. He's got a kind of a dual personality. Okay, he says some things. I don't think he thinks it through. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and beat him on Friday and shut him up and put that dual personality of his in the trash can. The outlaw, come on, dude. Take the hat off, take the mask off, and use your blinders if you want. Put some earphones on. I don't care what it is. I can't wait to meet you in the ring because you're going down. I'm just sick and tired of him. I'm just sick.
Damn.
Wow.
Damn.
I am. I'm
that
sick and tired of him.
That was the toughest thing I've ever heard
no,
you say.
No, I mean, he is tweeting at me. He's got these fans that are following him blindly, thinking that he can beat me. He's called me a has-been, which I am a has-been. I has been a champion.
Oh.
So you have a lot to bring to this thing. You're not going to have an easy Mrs. Doubtfire question to end the round, okay? Put on your big boy shorts. Let's do this, John Rocha. I can't wait.
Man. Yeah. All right. Them's fighting words. I
Rock
love it.
And
I
roll.
Love it. I love it. And you can find me at Clarke Wolfe. Clarke with an E, Wolf with an E. Not talking nearly as much smack, but I'm still there. And if you liked this video, it's Halloween, guys. Please share it. Tell your friends. Give it a thumbs up. Let's all get into the Halloween spirit together. Don't forget to watch Movie Talk tomorrow. And I think that's going to do it for us today. So until next time, we will see you in your nightmares.
If you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.